Welcome to Reframed. Join us as we explore the concept of redemptive business in our unique context on the African continent.
Hello, and welcome to the Big Change Podcast, where we are exploring how ordinary Christians can change their world. My name is Jonathan Wilson, and I'm your host. Today, I'm delighted to have Andy Crouch, a very dear friend of mine, join us on the podcast. Andy is partner for Theology and Culture at Praxis, which is a venture-building accelerator in the U.S. Welcome, Andy.
Thank you, Jonathan. Great to be here.
It's great to have you. So, Andy, you're U.S.-based, and for our listeners, I'm going to offer a few U.S.-Africa contrasts and comparisons.
There are some contrasts.
There are indeed. But firstly, just to clarify, the U.S. is a country, not a continent.
We often forget that here, but I believe there's two other nations on the continent, in fact.
Right. And just a reminder for our U.S. friends, you know, Africa is a continent and not a country.
Something else Americans often forget.
But anyway, to stay with the comparisons, the size. You could fit the United States three times into the continent of Africa. And one of the reasons I'm bringing this up is if you take those two continents and factor in, if you're an American, how diverse your own country is, you know, whether you're in Portland or Memphis, Tennessee, or Florida, or New York, those are completely different parts of the country with very different cultures and people groups. And if that's the diversity you get in the US, multiply that when you're in Africa, and you'll just have a sense of the richness of this continent as well. And of course, Africa is known for political instability and tribalism, but when we look from a distance at the US, we see maybe some of that going on over there as well.
I thought you were talking about America there.
Right, exactly. So anyway, somewhat in fun, just raising some of these points to highlight the fact that maybe things aren't as different as we sometimes make out. So we are on a journey in this podcast to highlight big change. But for many of our listeners, that big change is in Africa. That's where the focus is. And sometimes I think Africa is seen as simply a place of problems, when in fact, just like the States, it's a mix of both. And of course, we do have very real problems, very real legacies from the history of colonialism and other factors as well on this continent. So the fact is that we're on a continent that is, yes, has its problems, but is full of richness in culture and in opportunity. So Andy, returning to your continent and the one that I lived on for some 17 years, we both know that the US and Canada are well known for their export of what you might say are rather sanitized methodologies for, you know, running successful businesses, all kinds of silver bullets and magic formula. And some of the content is good, dealing with issues like purpose and culture and employee engagement and being customer-centric and so on. But so much of that falls into the category that you would call ethical. And you distinguish that from something that you would argue is actually better than ethical. So why don't you tell us a bit more about your problem with the language of, not the language, but with that approach, that ethical approach to business, and then what you guys are trying to do in contrast to that.
Yes, this is one of our core ideas at Praxis as we work with entrepreneurs, is that we actually think there are three ways to go out into the world in many realms of life, I guess, but including business. And ethical is one way. It's actually juxtaposed often to exploitative, that is going out into the world in ways that basically take advantage of others, in fact, take advantage of the planet, take advantage just to benefit at others' expense. And exploitative business is a reality, has been a reality in, you know, all over the world, including obviously in the United States. But many people, in fact, I would say most people aspire to something better than that. I don't think many people set out to exploit. There are notable visible exceptions, but mostly not. And mostly people aspire to be ethical. And as you say, a lot of business literature and discourse I would say, especially in the last few decades in the United States and our business schools and so forth, has at least paid lip service to the idea that business should be ethical. And actually, we at Praxis completely agree. So I have no problem with being ethical in and of itself. I think it's absolutely something everyone should aspire to, that most people do aspire to, and that for those of us who are Christian, is kind of a minimum baseline of how we ought to operate in the world, where we are fair in our dealings, we respect other people, we seek to advance culture, we seek to improve ourselves, we're kind of attentive to self-growth and that kind of thing. And all that's really good. At the same time, our own conviction at Praxis is that for those especially who are Christian, there's something more to chase after. And we call this redemptive work or redemptive life, really. And redemptive is a word that it never means less than ethical. It's not unethical, but it goes beyond the ethical. And the word itself is an economic word. It comes from a Latin root or roots that mean to buy back. And it has its origins in the ancient world that inform our scriptures, where often people and land in particular ended up essentially enslaved or entailed by debt. So to buy back something in the sense of redeeming, we actually still use it for debt instruments in finance. We talk about redeeming a bond. And once a bond is paid off, the debt is canceled. And in the same way in the ancient world, they didn't have those kind of financial instruments so much, but they did have a way for land and people to become enslaved in the case of people, or kind of permanently lost to a family who originally held the land in the case of land. And when you redeemed it, someone stepped in and paid a price such that now that land was returned to its family, or that person was returned to their freedom. And this word, I think in English now, sounds religious often when you say redemptive. And so what was originally an economic word becomes a kind of religious or theological word, properly and appropriately so. But we are actually trying to return it, without letting go of its religious kind of implications, return it to its economic implications. That is, if you believe this story is true, how do you go into the world as you're operating your business, or because we work equally with not-for-profits, your NGO or whatever? And we really believe it's an invitation to go beyond the ethical. The one more thing I might say here, Jonathan, is that, you know, why do we need to go beyond the ethical? Well, I think this is a failing of a lot of those shiny American business books that you read. I think the ethical approach to the world works very well in a world of fully functioning systems where other actors are also ethical. When you have ethical governance, when you have an ethical economy, an ethical industry or sector. And there are corners of the world where that is more or less true. So, you know, operating ethically, if the world's already ethical, it's good to be ethical. But what if the world you're in is actually damaged by exploitation, or bears the residue perhaps of generations of exploitation? And this is also true of our world, both in a place like the United States, but in many, many places all around the world and in all of human history. If it's damaged, or if it is currently in the grip of exploitation, our conviction is that ethical is not enough, because ethical cannot actually repair or undo the damage that exploitation is doing and has done. We're interested in the question, is it possible to actually do business in a world in a way that rescues, repairs, and we might say redeems? Not redeem in the sense of redeeming from sin, but in joining God in God's rescue mission for the world. And that's what we're after, and trying to find out how it works.
That's awesome. And I love the idea of an economic concept, in a sense, passing through the filter of what Christ has done for us and then being returned now through the way we're working with it to the economic world, to be taking on a richer meaning in the business context.
Yeah.
So Andy, before we go further, let's explain a bit more of your background to our listeners so that they know where you're even coming from. How did you get to where you are today, and why do you think the things that you think, and what has your career been to bring you to this place? So, as I mentioned before, Andy is partner for Theology and Culture for Praxis, where he serves as a teacher and a mentor and a framework builder. Now, Andy, what's a framework builder? If you could just enlighten me on that one.
Well, I find some of the best ideas are like they're like scaffolding that you can put your own life and work on. In other words, they're more invitations to see your own world rather than kind of taking you out of your world. And I think frameworks, when I have an idea that I think can just almost disappear into the texture of your life and serve as a model for your life, I feel like that's a helpful idea. So this idea of exploitative, ethical, and redemptive, though it's not a framework that I invented, I was a bit a part of it, but others in our community really advanced these ideas. When you have that kind of model, it's a beginning for your imagination. And I feel like at the best work I do is when I find a beginning point for how we imagine our work, not a total story, even just a framework. So I'm most excited when I can find frameworks that I can share with other people.
You've made a point there that I think is so key to the work of Christians in big change that we're talking about in this podcast. And that is that you said you built that framework in community. It wasn't just you, you know, Andy, the thought leader. And that's quite powerful. So glad that that emerged that way. So yeah, you do this work for your team. You do this work with the folk that are going through your accelerator program, the fellows, and you do it with the ecosystem as a whole. You're also a very well-published author. You've written most recently The Life We're Looking For. You wrote The TechWise Family. In fact, you also wrote a follow-up to that with your daughter, if I recall. You wrote Strong and Weak. You wrote Playing God, which was one of my favorites. And then way back in 2008, you had written Culture Making. And that has had a profound influence on many people and is still being used as a kind of, talking about framework, as a kind of framework for people in business, especially, but in other spheres to think about their work. So your work has been featured in the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, Time Magazine. But I know that you love the fact that maybe the highlight of your career is that Lecrae gave you a shout out in his 2014 single, Nonfiction. So listeners, look for that on Spotify. Find out.
That is the high water. That's the high water mark for sure. Especially in the mind of my then 14-year-old son. It was definitely the moment when dad actually mattered for a moment. Though I will say the reason it's a highlight is, you know, Lecrae is a very well-known rap, hip-hop and rap artist here in the U.S. And he actually raps not just about me, but it's the book Culture Making, the vision of, you know, being motivated by faith, who creates for a wide public, not for a narrow kind of Christian audience, but creates good in the world. And the fact that that was of any encouragement to this incredibly talented artist is just amazingly satisfying, I guess. And it's also a good credential.
So we also touched on your writing of the book TechWise, and you are a bit of a tech geek. You read about it. You're quite journalistic, given your background and how you look at these things. And you've sat in on some pretty interesting industry conversations on these subjects, haven't you? Be keen to hear a bit more about that.
Well, this is, you know, technology is the defining kind of economic engine of our time, without a doubt. And again, as it has been at several moments, I think, a really interesting inflection point where a lot is changing or beginning to change or is imagined will change. So yeah, in recent years, there have been some very compelling and distressing or disturbing or unsettling conversations, especially in places like, you know, San Francisco, the San Francisco Bay Area, where so much power and money and innovation is concentrated. So yeah, I've been trying to be good friends to people who live and work in that world, especially those who want their faith to actually shape what they're building. Mm. And I think we're actually at a very interesting moment where one of the inflections that I would say is happening is that technology, which I would define as kind of the result of autonomy and new forms of power. So things that can operate on their own and that have their own source of power, which was not true of most human work until about three generations ago. Up until very recently, the adoption of all these technologies, industrialization and computation, has fundamentally been accompanied by optimism. That is a sense of just tremendous hope and possibility. And you can go back and watch Steve Jobs premiering the iPhone in his keynote address in 2008. and the excitement in the room at this amazing thing that is about to be released into the world, it really feels at this moment like it's from another world, because now there is a great deal of ambivalence. So I would say it hasn't gone from optimism, say, to pessimism, but from optimism to deep ambivalence, deep questions, and doubt about what we're building, including those who are building the technology. And this is really a new thing. I think technologists have usually felt quite confident that the tech they're bringing into the world is going to be good for the world. And suddenly, the technologists, let alone the customers or the end users, are really asking, like, do I even want this thing in my life? So that's the most interesting development. And I think it reflects real concerns and a need to rethink what we're doing with technology and why and how we're going to deploy it in the world and what that's going to do to human beings as well as the planet that we're responsible for and share.
Yeah. Just to riff a little bit more off of the experiences that you've had looking at technology, can you unpack a bit further? What are some of the unhealthy or distorting assumptions or the distorting mental maps or frameworks that you see going on that are maybe illustrative of business as a whole, but being accentuated or attenuated? Things like AI and machine learning and various other more developed parts of technology are coming into full swing now. Mm.
Yeah, I think there are two frameworks or mental maps that we ought to be very cautious about. And we talk about this in our redemptive business playbook at Praxis. We call it the supremacy of money. So this is a very fundamental assumption of business in the kind of modern era. And you could say in the capitalist era, though we are in a kind of post-capital era in some ways, but we're still very much in a realm where money is treated as the supreme and in some cases only end of business. That is the generation of financially measurable return. And a financially measurable return is a good thing because it's an indicator of value created. And it's a very, very useful feedback loop, far better than most other options we have for judging good. And so I am for profit, you might say, even though I work with not-for-profits as well. I think every organization benefits from having a financial signal as well as an ongoing kind of source of energy, you might say, to be able to do its work. And that's essentially what profit is. But there's a difference between that and the supremacy of profit or the supremacy of money. And if you want to talk about this in a more Christian register, you might say, you have to wrestle with what Jesus says about what he calls mammon. And mammon, in one sense, is just an Aramaic word that roughly translates as money. And in some English Bibles, you'll just see Jesus saying, you cannot serve God in money. But in the Greek text of the New Testament, so Jesus is not speaking in Greek, he's speaking in Aramaic, but his Greek biographers translate his words. They don't translate the word mammon. They leave it untranslated. And that's why some English Bibles also leave it untranslated. And the reason is that the first Christians felt, as they reflected on this fundamental saying of Jesus, you cannot serve God and mammon, that he wasn't actually talking about a thing. He was talking about a kind of entity that we would identify as a demonic entity. That is, it has a name. It's a personal name. And we don't generally translate personal names. And mammon, in this way of thinking, is the kind of force in human affairs that I think has its own will, actually, that whispers into the ears of actors in the world, especially those in business or in places where money flows, and says, all you should care about is this immaterial representation of value. Mm. You should not care about actual value. That is, you should not pay attention to the good you are doing or not doing in the real world. You should not care about people, what you're producing, its effect on persons and their relationships with each other, in their families, in their communities, in their society, in their interconnectedness globally. You should ignore all those things and focus only on the multiplication of this ultimately just a representation of value, not value itself.
Yeah.
And the belief in Western business, but really I would say global business, because I think this applies just as much in China or, you know, any globally connected economic system, is that this is the only thing that business is allowed even to maximize. But the supremacy of money is very distorting. It is distorting how we apply technology, which is our latest kind of engine of growth economically. And what's happening is technology is being deployed. That is, our discoveries about the patterns of the world and the ways we can put them to productive use is being deployed not to benefit ordinary embodied human life. That is, to help people be more deeply human in the world. It is being deployed if and only if and only to the extent that it can generate financial profit measured in the terms of money. And I would say ultimately mammon. And I get this idea, by the way, that's not original with me. It's from a theologian and philosopher named Craig Gay, who's written very deeply about technology. And he says, this is the really striking thing about technology, is lots of technologies have not been deployed that would be very good for ordinary embodied human life, or have been insufficiently deployed, but lots have been deployed that undermine ordinary embodied human life, because technology actually is serving mammon and the supremacy of money, not serving human flourishing. And this is why, you know, Facebook, now Meta, can deploy all these algorithmic kind of incentives that actually incentivize you to be the worst you possible. They catch you at your most impulsive. By the way, this idea comes from my daughter, Amy. When I say I'm a framework builder, it really means I'm a framework borrower and framework identifier, and I just repackage them from other people. But my daughter, Amy, who is so thoughtful about these things as a young woman, says the problem with the algorithms, TikTok and all these social media algorithms, is they catch you at your least reflective and your most impulsive. And none of us are at our best at our least reflective and most impulsive. And then they incentivize that and keep giving you more of that. Why is that being deployed? Not because it's good for human beings to have their attention directed and deflected in this way, but because it's good for revenue. So the supremacy of money is one of the big things. And then the other one, I would say, the other framework that is absolutely driving our imaginations is actually even more ancient and fundamental than mammon, I think. And it's the framework of magic. And magic is the belief, the human kind of wish and intuition that there is some way for us to get things done in the world without love. That is, to accomplish something in the world, I actually would say even more than without love, without being a person, without having to relate to other persons, or without having to exert ourselves or become different in the world, that I can make a difference in the world without becoming different myself. So if I wanted to travel across the United States on a bicycle, and Jonathan, you were a much more serious cyclist than I ever was, but I do get out on my bicycle every day when the weather's nice. Suppose I wanted to do a really ambitious trip across the United States. I mean, I could train and become the kind of person who can ride 2,500 miles on a bicycle. That is possible. Or I can get on a plane and it requires absolutely nothing of me, right? So magic is the dream that I can get from here to there. You know, it's teleportation, right? And there's this long human story of dreaming, of being able to just translate yourself from one place to another with no effort. You don't become anything different. And in fact, as you sit on a plane, you become like less and less physically capable. And the difference between the kind of development of strength and heart and mind and soul that makes me the kind of person who can make a difference in the world. And that's, I think, what human beings are designed for. And the dream of being able to have all those changes happen. You know, I go from place to place. I learn about other parts of the world. I'm able to exert influence without any development of myself. That's the dream of magic. And that's the dream that animates a lot of technology. And the biblical witness is that both of these frameworks, the supremacy of money and mammon and the dream of magic, are like profoundly distorted and distorting fantasies of how the world ought to be that will actually undermine the good that we think we're going after. And they are very dominant in our world. So the great challenge, in a way, for those of us who are embedded in systems of money and embedded in this kind of magical world of technology, is to find a way to live and work that does not give in to those frameworks.
Mm. As you made that reference to my cycling, I remembered the fact that for every good race result or rare medal that I earned, I could tell you many, many stories of pain and suffering in the training and crashes as well, and all the marks on my body and the issues in my body that remain today because of those crashes.
Well, I just think that's really important. The other thing behind the dream of magic is a world without suffering. And of course, we want a world without meaningless suffering, but there is a meaningful implication in the pain of the world that is part of accomplishing good in the world. Mm. And this is, you know, most profoundly in the Christian doctrine of incarnation, that to save the world, God could not remain at a distance and just snap his fingers and make something happen. Even though God can act without embodiment, unlike us, and yet the ultimate rescue of the world required entering into the pain of the world. And there's something very fundamental to that that magic does not allow you to see. And I think that the ethical vision of, you know, we'll just be good people and that's all it will take, that underestimates the pain that we have to bear in order to rescue and repair.
I want to return to what you said about building those frameworks in community. And as Christians, we know that what we do today remains constrained. It remains limited. But we know as well that God's Holy Spirit is at work, not only in us as individuals, but in our fellow brothers and sisters in Jesus and in our brothers and sisters from history past. And so, Andy, when you say that you're largely a borrower of frameworks and ideas, I think really that's what we're talking about, is we pull from one another and we pull from the past and seek the wisdom of God to then reorient our minds and out of that, our actions. Now, you've been working very diligently over the years on what that actually looks like in action. And I know you've built some very important concepts around it to pull from or draw on game theory. So love to hear more about that. I think our listeners will be very interested.
Yeah, maybe I will frame this by picking up on something important that you said, which is that our kind of actions in the world often are so limited and we are very constrained in our options and constrained in the near-term effects of what we can do and what we can get done. And the beautiful thing is that the past that we get to draw on, especially as Christians, includes this incredible long collection of books that we call the Old Testament, in which over and over we see human beings very limited in what their circumstances allow and what their understanding allows, that many of them do not fully grasp who this God is or what he's doing. And yet they're able to make choices that become paradigmatic. You know, they become patterns for us. So for us, praxis, one of the most important examples of this is found in the book of Ruth. And the book of Ruth is the story of primarily three individuals, a woman named Naomi, who has lost her husband in this terrible catalog of calamities, famine and civil war and kind of economic collapse, civil collapse, this daughter-in-law, Moabite daughter-in-law, Ruth, and then ultimately this man who's a distant relative of Naomi's named Boaz. And all of them, when you step back from the text, are living in very, very constrained environments, actually in terrible times. The book of Ruth is set, the first words of the book of Ruth are in the days when the judges ruled. And in the Christian Bible, it follows the book of Judges, because that's the time that it's set in. And it's a terrible time for Israel and to be a person, frankly. And yet, Ruth and Boaz, and ultimately Naomi as well, get to experience a set of options in a way, or a set of choices that unlock a real redemption. And it's because Ruth and Boaz both take incredible risks. And one of the ways to think about what we see in the book of Ruth and at many other kind of key turning points is human beings very much in the midst of constraint and not seeing the full implications of what they're doing, still having to make choices. And when you make choices, you are doing what game theorists call playing a game. That is, all human interactions are based on some sense of a game that we're playing between us that we hope will turn out well for us. One game that you can play is called a zero-sum game, and this is the I win, you lose game. And so I can make choices, and if I'm in a constrained environment and you and I are in some kind of interaction, even including this conversation, one way to approach it is there's only so much good available in our limited world. I want as much as possible, and so I'm going to try to get it at your expense. I win, you lose. And I would call this fundamentally the exploitative game. And it doesn't just have to be like a business transaction. It can be in a conversation. You can be playing the game of how do I win? How do I make myself look good at Jonathan's expense? Or how do I kind of elevate myself by belittling you? And we've all been in conversations where it kind of dawns on you, the game that's being played here is I win, you lose. And we've been on both ends. I think this is the kind of humbling reality of exploitation, is you can probably, if you happen to be married, you can think of a time when you were in this with your spouse and they were trying to win and you were losing. But you can also think about times when you were trying to win at their expense. And exploitation is just kind of in the fabric of our hearts in a kind of very tragic way. So I win, you lose is the exploitive game. It ends up being highly transactional in the sense that I'm treating you as a means to an end that I'm seeking, and I'm not treating you as an end. I'm not treating you as something, as someone worthy in and of yourself of my love and respect. There's another way. And by the way, so in the book of Ruth, Ruth and Naomi and eventually Boaz are surrounded by people who treat the world this way. The judges in Israel, for all their moments of bringing some measure of civil order, often have also behaved like a figure like Samson in extremely selfish ways, right? It's kind of the pattern of leadership is selfishness. When Ruth arrives in Boaz's town of Bethlehem and goes out to glean in the fields, Boaz has to specifically instruct his young men, do not trouble her, which really means do not assault her, because sexual assault and abuse and exploitation of the vulnerability of women is a huge part of the kind of taken for granted background of this world. So exploitation and win-lose games are in the environment all around them, and they have to decide whether they're going to play that game or not. Second kind of game you can play is not a zero-sum game, but what we call a positive-sum game. And in a positive-sum game, the kind of model is I win, you win. This is a phrase from ethical business in the US, win-win, right? This is a win-win situation. In a win-win situation, I no longer am winning at your expense. We're finding a way to cooperate such that we unlock value. And at the end of the day, there's more abundance in the world than there was at the beginning because we've found a way to cooperate. And I would call this the ethical way of operating. And I think it's a beautiful thing to aspire to and often is achievable. In many situations, you can actually set up a positive sum solution. And in some ways, when Ruth returns to Bethlehem with her mother-in-law and begins gleaning in the field, this is an example of a kind of ethical arrangement, gleaning being the system by which the people who did not have land anymore because they'd lost it to famine or disease or whatever, it had been entailed and lost, still could harvest grain. And they harvested at the edges of the field. The field was left. You didn't harvest all the way to the edges if you were the landowner. And in that setting, everyone gets to leave at the end of the day with a harvest. And no one is dependent on charity. Everyone gets to work. There's opportunity for everyone, even the poor who have no land. And it's a beautiful system that Boaz has preserved in obedience to Torah, which commands this kind of ethical way of living. And in our world, I think there's lots of times when we can actually come to kind of mutually beneficial arrangements. But I would say that that falls short of the third game that it turns out somebody has to be willing to play for the world to be repaired, for the world to be restored. There's some settings where you can't, there is no win-win solution. And Naomi is sort of in this situation where she's lost her husband, she's lost her sons. She's now in the incredibly vulnerable position of being a widow, actually being in a way a foreigner. She's moved away for a long time, has just come back to her hometown. And, you know, widow, orphan, and stranger, the one who has lost a husband, the one who has lost parents, or the one who has lost their homeland are the categories of biblical vulnerability. And Naomi is two, or maybe in a sense, three out of three. And in that situation, how is good going to be restored to Naomi? There's not an obvious like win-win solution. Something is going to happen to restore her. And of course, the book of Ruth is about what happens. And you would ask, well, what's the game? Is it I win, you lose? That's not going to help Naomi. Is it win-win? Naomi's not really in a position to provide a benefit to anyone, right? So there's no win-win solution like there is in a commercial contract where you provide a service, I provide a payment. So then you ask, well, what's this third game that I'm going to call the redemptive game? And you think, is it I lose, you win? That is it I lose and you win at my expense? That doesn't sound very appealing. But in fact, our conviction at Praxis has come to be that there's another way to describe this, which is I sacrifice and we win. It's not I lose, you win. It's I sacrifice, we win.
If you've been enjoying the conversation so far, please share with your friends so that more people can discover how their faith can shape a better world.
And what makes this different from I lose, you win is two things. One is, in a win-lose environment, you usually would never choose to lose. You'd never choose to just be the loser in a transaction. And sacrifice is chosen loss. It's the willingness to actually take a risk in the belief that there's some abundance that we can't currently see that will only be unlocked if I'm willing to go first and risk losing something. And so sacrifice is chosen. I'm not using it in the sense of sacrifice that someone else makes you make or becoming a human sacrifice where the human sacrifice has no choice in the matter. It's when you voluntarily decide, I am going to give something up because I believe there's something more beautiful actually available than we can currently see. And Naomi experiences this when, after having told her daughters-in-law, go back home because I'm heading back to Bethlehem. There's nothing for you there. You're Moabites. You will also be strangers, widows, and orphans there. Go back home. And one of the daughters does the ethical thing, kisses her mother-in-law, and goes home. But Ruth sings this incredible song, where you go, I'll go. Where you lodge, I'll lodge. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. And I'm bound to you no matter what. And in a way, that's a huge sacrifice for Ruth. She's committing herself to go to a place where she doesn't speak the language, will be stigmatized as a foreigner, has no certainty that she'll be cared for. But she sees something in Naomi and in their relationship. And the fact that she says, your God, my God, I think she senses like there's something in Israel's God that she can't find in the gods of Moab. And she says, I'm willing to lose my identity as it's been and take on a new identity as your beloved daughter-in-law in this new place. But what this kind of sacrifice does is it creates a we. So The normal game theory involves independent actors who each decide what's good for them. And they either act exploitatively or ethically. They either act in win-lose ways or win-win ways, but it's always I and you. What sacrifice does is create, it binds us together. It creates a we. And together we discover there are possibilities available that were not available when we were independent actors. And in fact, when they get back to Bethlehem, though initially they can't see how, Naomi's prospects are so much better because Ruth has come with her than if Naomi had returned alone. And then they find themselves connected to this man named Boaz, who then himself engages in incredible sacrifice after this crazy encounter on the threshing floor in the middle of the night, where Boaz decides to actually take Ruth as his wife and take on the kind of burdens of this family, and thereby also restore the land that the family had lost and the line that the family had lost. And Boaz and Ruth, out of love, enter into marriage, and marriage is kind of the ultimate example, actually, of I sacrifice, we win. Because to marry someone, especially in Boaz's situation, to marry a foreigner, to marry into a family where he's now kind of taking on the family's debts and obligations, rather than just being able to maintain his own line. Like, this is a sacrifice, but all marriage is like this. But it also creates a new solidarity in the world, a new community in the world. And in the case of Boaz and Ruth, creates a baby, and maybe more than one. But this particular baby, Obed, turns out to be very important because four generations later, this is the grandfather, I guess, of David and the great-great-great-great-great-grandfather of Jesus. How is this a pattern for us? I think it's a pattern in that if we can have the courage to bind ourselves to people often in very difficult situations and to enter into very painful realities, we can create a new we that experience a kind of abundance that is not present if you're just playing this arm's length win-win game, let alone win-lose game. Does that make sense? I realize it's a lot to take down, but I think this is the redemptive pattern, is I sacrifice, we win.
Yeah, there's something very counterintuitive about this idea of sacrifice, which for us would normally represent something that we would feel threatened by. It results in loss or death, when in fact, it has a multiplier effect, basically.
Exactly.
And results in something very fruitful. I mean, everything that you've described there, Andy, is such a rich and beautiful inversion of the usual playbook, you know, that we have for business. But what I actually, as I was listening to you, I was thinking, okay, you know, we have a lot of audience members who are Christians that grown up in the Christian community, but we also have audience members who are not. And I wonder whether some of our listeners are finding this rather bizarre that we're consulting a story that is, 3,000 plus years old. And yet I think that's part of what's key in the Jewish and in the Christian testimony of God, is that he has worked patiently, sometimes slowly, in ways that to us seem to riff on language that we've used a lot in this podcast, to work in seemingly very ordinary situations to bring about what is extraordinary. And more than that, to in each of these episodes in God's the history of God's work in this world, we see these fundamentals of the wisdom with which he made this world, that it arises out of that willingness to serve one another with complete abandon, with complete freedom, rather than working from a place of self-protection.
Can I interject that I know this text is 3,000 years old, or this specific story is, you know, roughly 3,000 years in the past, but it's so contemporary. I mean, the situation of being an immigrant, of having experienced famine and civil war and displacement, losing a husband, losing sons. I mean, there are people all over our world today who are experiencing the same thing. So in a way, it's a very distant world, but it's also extremely close to all of us. And the real challenge is not the age of the story. It's the wager that is required. It's the bet on there being more abundance than we can see. There is a very fundamental difference between a scarcity mindset, that the ultimate scarcity mindset says, I can only win at your expense. But I actually think the win-win ethical vision is also marked by a limitation of imagination. It says, if we can find a contract that will that we can both agree on that will kind of serve us well, then we can do business. But what if you're in a situation where there's a lot of chaos and disorder, or where a lot of exploitative actors are actually winning? If you're just ethical, you'll just walk away and you'll say, well, I can't do anything about that. And there's whole industries, there's whole nations where things have broken down to the extent that it's very hard to act ethically. And of course, we see this. This is an issue even in investment, for example, in many of the countries of Africa, where ethical investors from, say, the West, from Europe or North America say, oh, we want to invest, but we're ethical. And then they look at situations of great complexity where a lot of things have broken down and there's a legacy of exploitation that has to be reckoned with. And they just say, oh, well, we can't invest there.
Yeah.
And what you're doing when you do that is you're just deciding kind of there's whole regions of the world and human experience that we can't make a difference in. The I sacrifice, we win way, the redemptive way, is the only way to enter into broken realities that are doing damage to people and to societies and to the planet, and say, I think I'm going to bet on there being a redemptive possibility here. You can't do that foolishly. And it's always a wager. It's not, you can't assume it's going to work out. And this is where the real challenge for us is in these biblical models, is that the biblical actors, you could say, these individuals who are in situations very much like our own, decide to bet on a greater goodness being available than they themselves can see. And we have to decide. And I actually think just because you call yourself Christian doesn't mean you're willing to make that bet. And just because you're not Christian doesn't mean you can't choose. Because Ruth is not an Israelite. She doesn't initially know anything about the God of Naomi. And yet she loves her mother-in-law and decides, I'm going to go all in with you. And that's the basic redemptive move.
What I hear you describing is, in given the context that we live in a world that is broken, that does have damaging exploitative systems, that if we're only prepared to take on the ethical mode of engagement, we will only ever be able to settle for managing things as opposed to transforming things.
Yes, 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 yes.
So now, if that's a path in front of us, or if there's a fork in the road and the one fork is ethical and the other is redemptive, the challenge is, and it's been implicit in our whole conversation, is what kind of person do I have to be or to become to be redemptive from the core? From my many years in the management consulting space, I can remember countless conversations where people express this longing to be, they wouldn't have called it redemptive, but in some way to make a difference that went way beyond what they could see as being possible in their worlds. I remember, to give you one example, being in the office in a high rise in Toronto of one of Canada's biggest banks. A colleague and I were having a sales conversation with the investment arm of that bank. And it was the CEO of that division. My company at the time was called Soul Systems, with Soul being S-O-U-L, the center of a person and their personhood. And she said, soul systems, are you talking about the soul of a business? And I said, yes, I am. And she looked quite animated as she asked that question. And then she sat back and her face fell and she looked extremely sad, actually. And she suddenly said, we have no soul in our bank.
Wow.
I've encountered that many times. It's as if this transactional world of commerce that we're in is saying to people, this is it. And the best you can do is to be ethical. And we're saying, no, there's actually another possibility. Before we dig any deeper into that, let's return to this letter. Again, talking about going back to texts that are thousands of years old. This one is a couple thousand years old. The letter that Paul wrote to what would have been back then the tiny, tiny communities of Christians that were in the Roman Empire, in this case, in the city of Colossae, which was in what we now know as Turkey. So we'll start with some words of Paul's in Colossians chapter 2, verse 11 through 13, where he says that in Jesus you, those who are listening to his letter, have also been circumcised, not with a circumcision by human hands, but in the stripping of the physical body that happened in the circumcision of the Messiah, of Jesus on the cross. And you have been buried together with him in baptism, and also raised together with him through the faithful working of God's power when he raised Jesus from the dead. So what Paul's communicating here is that if someone has received Jesus as the Lord, as the Messiah, as this rescuing king, then they've somehow shared in this dying moment that he went through on our behalf. Quite the what that means, we'll come back to it. It's very mysterious at first blush. And then he goes on to say, and you who were dead in the sense of spiritually dead, where we were dead in our wrongdoing and in the uncircumcision of our self-serving nature, were made alive together with Jesus, who forgave us all our wrongdoing. Then he goes on to say a few verses later, but if you have died with Christ, in other words, the Messiah, to the fundamental powers of the cosmos, then why do you live in submission to them? And I'm not going to read all the verses that follow here because they're quite complicated, but he then basically is summarizing the kinds of rules that historically people have made in their religious or other systems, and he describes these as self-religion, manufactured humility, and exaggerated self-discipline, and you could match that to a whole bunch of self-help or, you know, keys and secrets to an abundant life that we get given today. And then he goes on to say, but these are without any value because they simply indulge the self. In other words, they locate salvation back with us, and that keeps us in our defeated position. So then he goes on to say, but if you've been raised together with Messiah, seek that which is above where the Messiah is, enthroned at the right hand of God. Set your minds on that which is above, not on what is on earth, for you have died. Okay, so we were dead spiritually. Now we've actually died in some manner, and your life is concealed with Messiah or with Jesus in God. And when the Messiah, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed together with him in a state of glory. And then he has more to say. He's now moving into the space of our behavior, in a way of our ethics. But again, he's touching on what you've been talking about, Andy. He says, put to death. So there's something in us that's died in a good way. We'll come back to that. But then he says, put to death, therefore, whatever part of you is earthly. And he talks about immoral sexual relations. So there's a dimension of sexuality that we distort and it harms. He talks about a moral kind of dirtiness. He talks about self-serving passions, evil desires that drive us. And then he says, and greed, which is the worship of a false god, or which is idolatry, as it's often translated. So then he says, then you have been stripped of the old self. So the stripping that happened to Jesus on the cross is extended to us, and we've been stripped of this old self, this ugly dimension to who we are with its practices, and have clothed yourselves with the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of its creator. And in this image, there's no longer Greek or Jew, circumcised, uncircumcised. Elsewhere, Paul says male or female, barbarian, which for those of our listeners who are South African is basically another way of saying amakwerekwere, Scythian, which is a foreigner. Enslaved or free, but instead Jesus is all and in all. There's more I could read, but I'll close with these lines from Colossians where he says, above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of the Messiah have the final say. in your hearts. So what does it take to become this kind of a person and who is willing to relinquish because of the way it gives life? And Paul's basically saying, you can't. You can't become that person. Something has to be done to you in order for this to happen. You need to be rescued. Now, in the days before modern medicine, the only way a plague would stop was when its victim died and the pathogen had nowhere else to go, no other host to go to. So it's quite interesting that in another letter, Paul said, and this is in his letter to the Romans, chapter 6, verse 7, that someone who has died has been freed from sin. So basically, you can't be free of this problem until you die. Well, that kind of sucks, because that's rather terminal. And then what's going to come after that? But this is the point of redemption, is that we get to die before we get to die, or before we have to die. And it's because Jesus dies on our behalf. And there's a death to this pathogen. There's a death to this problem of the, what Paul calls the flesh, this need to live within our self-serving nature, this need to be in control, this need to be one's own personal arbiter, to be one's own God, really, which, as we know, underlies every sin that you could list, every evil in this world that you could list. And it's at this point, I want to take us back to a story that I shared in the third episode about a Scandinavian tourist who I met in Papua in Indonesia. And if you go back to the episode, you'll hear this incredible story of how a woman who'd grown up in a world where there's complete skepticism towards Christian faith. One day she said to me, "You know, Jonathan, I've just been reading Jesus' words, and I think he's such a cool guy. But then he says this thing that, to be honest, I just think is absurd. He says that if you want to keep your life, you have to lose it. He says that you have to lay down your life and take up your cross, which of course is an instrument of death, if you're going to follow him." And if you go back and hear the story, you'll know that it was actually quite a while after that that she kind of came to that gulf, that decision where she knew that she was going to have to make this decision. This decision that I think is terrifying because it does actually require a death on our part. It's not a true dying. That's the gift of it. But Jesus brings us to this place where in order to receive what he has to offer, we have to completely give up our need to be in control. We have to completely give up our self-authority to be our own God. But in doing so, we're relinquishing ourselves not to nothing, but to him, the image of God, the image of God. And we're relinquishing ourselves to him who is the wisdom within which all creation finds its meaning and its shape. And this is where I wanted to come to. As I was listening to you earlier, Andy, I just thought that this is the key, that if you're going to be this person who's redemptive, that requires the sacrifice that you talked about. It requires that self-giving. And who's going to give of themselves when everything about their identity is wrapped up in protecting themselves? And I think that it's probably safe to say that the end destination of a creation where all things are restored is one in which flourishing is a result of every single human that participates in the cosmos being a person of self-giving love rather than self-protecting or self-serving. And the only way for that to happen is when that self-serving nature is actually dead. It can't even raise its head.
You know, the core framework we use at Praxis is this exploitative, ethical, redemptive kind of set of options. And we actually map it onto three dimensions, which is your strategy needs to be not exploitive and not merely ethical, but redemptive. Your operations, which is kind of how you do the work, needs to have that pattern. And then we talk about leadership, the kind of heart of the person leading or founding the enterprise. And I've presented this in, you know, business school context in the United States. And when you talk about your strategy being redemptive, that is aiming to actually bring products and services into the world that renew and repair the world, that aren't just sort of good, but actually restorative. Everyone's very excited about that. And when you talk about your operations being not using people or just respecting people, but actually blessing people such that it's you know, not just sort of I'm treated well, but I'm actually, I flourish in a kind of way that you would describe as blessing. People like that a lot. They're like, oh, we'd love to be part of businesses like that. And then we get to our leadership axis where we play out these three and we say, you know, the exploitative way to be a leader is to live for yourself. And everyone kind of gets, you don't want to, you know, that's not a good leader. And then the ethical way, we say, is to improve yourself. It's to be a good person, maybe even a better person. And people are very open to that. But our take based on this passage from Colossians and many others, the whole kind of arc of the revelation of God's wisdom in the Bible, is we say the redemptive way to be a leader is to die to yourself. And that is the moment when you completely lose the business school audience. Like, you know, at least in their, with their business school hat on. And sometimes some of them are Christians. They're like, oh, I get it. But we don't teach that here. We, you know, it's not in our ethics course. But we actually believe it's the foundation of the whole thing. And this is why I think, you know, the entrepreneurs we work with, they're not starting what you would call like Christian businesses in the sense that everyone who works for the business is a Christian, or, you know, you operate in some kind of Christian subculture where you only serve Christians or only have Christians as vendors. This is meant to be played out in the world. At the same time, I do kind of think the agents of real repair and restoration have got to have gone through some kind of death to self. And ultimately have to follow Jesus all the way in what he says, take up your cross, to be fully part of restoration. And in a way, if you think of leaders who did not necessarily fully consider themselves Christian, I think this might have been the case for Nelson Mandela, who had a complex relationship, at least with the Christian faith that was part of his schooling and so forth. But he had experienced a measure of death to self in his imprisonment, especially on Robben Island. He comes back a very different kind of leader from that experience. And it unlocks restoration in a way that an undying kind of improvement would not have. But the Christian conviction is you've got to go kind of all the way to the cross in a way. And, yeah. And if we don't do that, we will be limited in what we can repair. And if you think there's nothing of importance to be repaired or it's not your job to repair, then maybe that's okay. But if you feel a sense of responsibility for the legacy of exploitation, the very hard good news is it's going to involve death to self, but it also therefore involves love. It also therefore involves the creation of a we, that incredible sequence in Colossians and elsewhere in Paul's letters where he says there's no longer these divisions between people of slave and free or male and female or Jew or Greek or barbarian and Scythian, but we are now bound to each other. And that's the really the essence of the restoration that has to happen in the world. So that's the invitation. And then you just decide, do I believe enough in the goodness of God and the life that's revealed in Jesus to think I want it? And it's pretty legitimate to say, no, thank you. But you might be missing out on the real life.
Yeah. And in the world that you and I move in, and probably the majority of our listeners, the business world, like you say, it would actively counter that. It is a place built on self-interest. And yet the mechanisms of business, as Alice and I talked about last week, are actually well-suited to doing good. And Alice and I talked about the accountability mechanisms that drive quality and value creation that the not-for-profit world can't have because the buyer can hold the service provider accountable. And you know, you've touched on the creative power that is so often present in the commercial world. Again, that creativity is enhanced by the marketplace mechanisms. They lend themselves to that. But if self-interest is at the heart, then ultimately, again, we will only settle for this low bar of extractive results instead of truly generative results. Andy, before we finish, you've had two or three examples that you've mentioned to me in the past of companies that are modeling this. And I think it'd be great to hear at least a couple of them before we wrap up.
Yeah, the beautiful thing about Praxis is we keep meeting people who really are pursuing this way and have gone through at least enough dying to self that they have seen some redemptive results. And one that's quite exemplary, I would say, is a firm called Chatham Financial, which was founded by a man named Mike Bontrager, with some early collaborators, of course. And Mike had worked in the finance world. He'd worked at Goldman Sachs, and he was sort of casting about for a way to do finance on his own. He started this firm. And, you know, initially, I think Mike would say, not with a particularly redemptive vision. He was Christian, a son of a pastor, but, you know, trained in the world of finance and just looking for a niche to serve. And Chatham, early in its history, found its way to a part of the financial markets that is so obscure and so mathematical that I really have no idea what it is, but it's called defeasance. And it involves basically hedging risk in relating to, among other things, currency exchange risk. And it's truly beyond my capacity to describe. And that's actually what made it very, very fertile terrain for exploitation, because the major players who would help municipal governments or large enterprises hedge their risks understood this complex financial derivatives world at a conceptual level, but also they just had lots of information about it that their customers did not have. And they were using this information to write extremely favorable contracts to themselves that actually took great advantage of people who were just trying to take some risk off the table that had nothing to do with their business, you know, the risk of currency fluctuation and so forth. And so when Chatham entered this business, it really was highly exploitive in the sense that the big players, the big Wall Street firms that all of us have heard of, were winning at the expense of their customers. And Mike, by this time, had begun to imagine a higher purpose for Chatham than just maximizing profit. And he had come to say to his team, what if our job is not to maximize profit, but to maximize trust? If trust is really the engine, or that's not quite the right word, if trust is like the underpinnings of actually economic transaction, because if I can't trust you, I won't freely transact with you. Maybe what we need to do is in our work as a business, not so much maximize our own profit, but maximize the trust between us and our clients. And this led them to reconsider how defeasance was sold. And they decided we are actually going to be very profoundly transparent in how we price these transactions. And we're going to give our clients all the same information that we have about the market that we're helping them navigate. And this resulted in far more favorable terms for the clients. In the immediate like reference frame, less profit for Chatham. Chatham could have played the same game and perhaps outcompeted, you know, the Goldmans of the world. But they just felt like their job was to maximize trust, not profit. So what ended up happening is suddenly the clients understand the kind of environment they're in. And they go back to some of the bigger firms and say, well, you need to reprice these contracts because this is not really a fair contract. And you can imagine the bigger players. And so, you know, Chatham is a very small firm at this time, and it's competing against these massive Wall Street firms. You can imagine it was not received particularly positively by the incumbent exploiters, right? But what has happened in the past decade as Chatham has pursued this model of maximizing trust rather than maximizing profit is the entire like little niche domain that we call defeasance has been redefined by the small little actor who decided we're going to be truthful, honest, and transparent and maximize trust. And now the big firms also have to compete on those terms. And by the way, Chatham grew to be an 800-person company, has been extremely successful, has been able to enter other markets in finance and see similar kind of transformations. And they've done just fine. I think it's fair to say they're in an engine of incredible prosperity for the town they live in, which is not far from where I live in Pennsylvania. And they've done it by having just a different model. But it started with a sacrifice, the sacrifice of information you had that your customer didn't have. And I think that's a beautiful template. Like if someone is willing to die to themselves, both as a leader and as in a sense as an investor or an owner, and say, let's create a we here with our clients where we serve them well. And of course, we get paid an appropriate, you know, fee for serving them. You actually can reset like the possibilities of exploitation in a whole industry, potentially. I think about another very different firm I was with recently. I was consulting with them. So for confidentiality reasons, I won't say the name, but let's just call them Tech Corp. They're in the oil and gas services business. And so they're in a kind of dirty, grubby business, frankly, where there's a lot of very large and established incumbents again. And they're a privately held firm led by an incredibly redemptive leader who want to do things differently. And one of the things they want to do differently is where their labor force comes from. And they have decided that one of their principal opportunities is to employ people who are returning from incarceration in the U.S. We, of course, incarcerate more of our citizens on a percentage basis than almost any other country. And many of those folks come out of prison and there is almost nowhere for them to go to find work, especially good work. And Tech Corp has made part of its organizational mission, employing people who really in any other setting would be disqualified, but who in fact have tremendous motivation and ability to do good work. And while, you know, they're in this massive global industry we call oil and gas that is frankly quite hard to reset the fundamental terms of. But in terms of what's happening for the people they employ, it's like radically different to work for this company is just at any level, not just the like factory and warehouse jobs that often the folks returning from prison are initially able to fill, but all the way up to the management and executive leadership. They recruit mostly from big corporates like Halliburton and these other big services firms. And as I met with the different layers of leadership in this organization, you could almost see as they've grown just in the last few years, doubled their own headcount from about 250 to 500 employees. You have all these new people coming into this company, and it just has a totally different way of doing business. And you can still see their like wide-eyed wonder at the idea that they're going to be treated like a person, that they're going to be given kind of freedom to do the right thing, even when it's not profitable in the short run. I sat in on a meeting where in the course of answering some other question, the CEO, who is also the majority owner, said, I don't know what our quarterly results were last quarter. I don't need to know. I don't want to know, because we are about creating long-term multiples on investment, not creating short-term IRR, internal rate of return. And you could just look around the room. There were about 40 middle management people in this room, all of whom had come from big corporations. And the sort of astonishment that the CEO would just casually say, I don't need to know the quarterly results because we're creating a different kind of value, a longer term kind of value. And the freedom and the lightness and the possibility and the energy that is released by that to do really good work and to outcompete these big firms is incredible. So, you know, this is, none of this is easy and none of it's simple and none of it happens totally. I think the story of Chatham has its own complications. The story of this tech corp is certainly complicated. And yet there is a meaningful difference that's been made, often outside even of the direct scope of these companies. They've been able to affect the way things are done far beyond their own sort of sphere of direct control. And that's the redemptive vision and the redemptive play in a way.
No, that's fantastic. And I think what's important about both stories that you shared is you're being faithful in a sense to what you know is right and good and true in your context. You can't, you know, Chatham House could not fix the whole system, the whole industry. It had to start with where it was at. And same with this company, right. This oil and gas company that you mentioned, or they're in that industry. Is it a problematic industry? Yes, it is. But we can't fix the whole thing. And that's one of the themes of this podcast, is that big change is ultimately the accumulation of these smaller impacts over time, these smaller areas of transformation that really ultimately start with our own personal transformation.
That was also true for Ruth, by the way. I mean, Ruth is an immigrant to a completely messed up society that is Israel in the time of the judges. But because of her sacrificial redemptive risk, and then because of Boaz's sacrificial redemptive risk, because there really are two redeemers in the Book of Ruth. It's Ruth to Naomi, and then Boaz to Ruth and Naomi. Four generations later, there is someone named David who is able to restore a measure of civil order, of good governance, of proper worship. And David is not a perfect king, but he's better than what comes before. He's far better than the judges. And so you have to think multi-generationally that your redemptive choice today, it may not be for three or four generations that the full import of that is seen. But, you know, the reason the Book of Ruth is in the Bible is that this was the hinge point. This was the turning point from an environment of deep and profound chaos to the restoration of a way of being a nation that was better for people and ultimately gave more glory to God. The redemptive way, I sacrifice, we win. Like, it is a long bet on the long goodness of the God who's revealed in Jesus. And you either take it or you don't. But I think if you don't take it, you miss out on some quite remarkable stories.
Yeah. Well, Andy, I think that's a great place to bring our conversation to close. I'm hoping that as our listeners have walked with us through this conversation, that there's a couple key things that will hit home. The first is that the business world as we know it, which we tend to aspire to a certain standard of success, that standard is deeply suboptimal. We actually shouldn't be aspiring to it. Secondly, I think that you set and you've described a much higher bar for what's possible, much more rich, much more meaningful, much more transformational. And it doesn't require abandoning business and running off over to the, you know, not-for-profit sector. It just requires being faithful to these principles in the world of commerce. And thirdly, that our listeners are encouraged that the defeaters, the inner defeaters in our life, don't have to prevent us from pursuing this path, but we rather, but instead we actually have access to the God of creation who has offered us himself to be these agents of redemption in our world. So that brings us to the end of this episode. Thank you very much, Andy. It's really been good.
Thank you so much. Great to have this conversation.
Thank you for joining us. This episode of Reframed was brought to you by Ziwani, a community of business leaders who partnered together to live out their kingdom calling in the marketplace within Africa. Ziwani is a Mergon initiative. To know more about us, visit our website at ziwani.com. That's ZIWANI.com.